singing, Holy, Holy Yahweh Almighty.
We're singing,
Holy.
Almighty Yahweh promises to gather everyone he scatters. I am a Hebrew. We are Hebrew.
I am a Hebrew. I was born in Texas.
I am a Hebrew, and I am from Florida.
I'm a Hebrew, and I was born in California.
I am a Hebrew, and I was born in San Diego, California.
I'm a Hebrew. I was born in Indiana.
I'm a chosen generation, a royal priesthood. I am a Hebrew, and I was born in Spain.
私は Hebrew で、日本で生まれました。
Soy hebrea. Nací en Puerto Rico.
I am a Hebrew. From West Africa, Liberia.
I am a Hebrew, and I was born in Straight Lane.
We are Hebrew.
Aloha, my sister.
Shalom, shalom, daughters of Zion. Greetings from the Straightway Tabernacle. I'm your host tonight, and I am alone. Sister Jennifer, shout out to you. She got last week off because I had Sister Carol on, and she gets this week off because I have Pastor Dow sitting right beside of me. And for the most of you, you're tuned in just because he is here. Shout out to Sister Carol, Mother Carol. Thank you so much for last week's wonderful message. A lot of sisters were edified. I actually got to keep the notes, and I've been reading them before bedtime every night. So you know I was edified, Mother. Shout out to our pregnant sisters, Tamika, Melina, Evelyn. Keep your spirits right. Stay positive. And thanks to Pastor for showing up tonight. I don't got a lot to ramble about. We're going to get straight to it. I will rely completely upon your calls tonight. Thank you for the tens and the sound checks. I need you all to call in. I have one question for Pastor, and depending on how the show goes, I may develop more. But last time we had him on air live with the Sister to Sisters program, I asked the questions and no one called in. So this time it's all about you. This is your opportunity to call him, to speak to him. His time is very important. This is a man who travels. He ministers. He builds. He communicates. He teaches us how to protect ourselves. He teaches us to arm ourselves, to store food, to store silver, and how to think according to a Hebrew way. And lastly, and most importantly, how to interpret the scriptures correctly. And we bless him for his time. He is here for each of you. Please call in tonight. It should start now. Call in now. If you got questions, they should be lining up. Now's your chance, sisters, provided you have asked your husbands, for those of you who are married. And that's just honor. That's actually Pastor showing honor to the husbands that are out there, as many that may be offended by him even stating that on a video. It's him merely honoring the husband as the head of the home by him suggesting that you ask your husband if you may call in. So 310-982-4226. I will not keep this man's time. It's too precious to me. So you keep it. You ask. You make the show, Daughters of Zion. So I wanted to give another shout-out really quickly before I go to Pastor to my husband. Some of you may not know my husband. Some of you may not know or ever speak to him or see him. When you come around for big events, most of the time the husbands and wives on the land don't spend a lot of time together for events. We're fellowshipping and we're scattered apart. My husband is Doug Bell, and he allows me to do this show. He has put in words of wisdom to every show you have ever heard me say or anything that you've ever heard me represent. About this ministry, I've ran everything by him, every show, all my notes, all my thoughts, and many, many, many hundreds of times probably has he given very wise words for me to share with y'all just in my own way of presenting it. So shout out to my husband that I acknowledge first and foremost. And Pastor, do you have anything to start off or just a shalom, sir? Anything to say? Say hi. I got one question for you, sir.
No, shalom. Glad I'm here. I'm glad I'm able to be here to be with all of you. The guest calling number is 310-982-4226. If you'd like to get in the caller queue and speak to myself, Sister Ashley, whatever question you may have, once you get into the caller queue, you press number one. When you press number one, when you get in the caller queue, you hear the lady. She'll tell you that you are in the caller queue. If you do not hear the lady, then that means you're not in the caller queue. You're just there listening. Again, 310-982-4226.
Hallelujah. All right, we got two calls already. I appreciate all of you being obedient, using this time wisely to speak to your pastor.
Yeah, because this could be either the longest or the shortest broadcast we've ever had in history of Sisters and Sisters.
Hallelujah. Could be. It looks like, Sister Ray, let's see if it is. Area code 512, you're live with Pastor Down, Sister to Sister. What say you?
Yes, ma'am. Shalom, shalom.
Shalom. We hear you very well. Go ahead.
Hallelujah. Bless you, Pastor. Bless you, Sister Ashley. My question is real quick. I just wanted to know, is there anything wrong with women playing musical instruments?
No, not at all. But whenever you look in scriptures, you notice that a lot of times that the women was up front doing the singing. And that's the reason why you see here at Straightway in the ministry, you see our sisters was up front singing. That's not exclusive, just the women alone. But we try to do everything we can to get as close to the scriptures as possible, knowing that the Holy Spirit is definitely there with us. But no, women can play musical instruments just as well. And men can sing too, because we got men singers and women singers. So, hey, you can play a musical instrument if you're good and put the time, energy, and effort into it.
Yes, sir. Well, hallelujah. That was all I have. Thank you for your time, Pastor. And thank you as well, Sister Ashley.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you for calling. Shalom.
Shalom.
All right, we're moving right along. Let's go, area code 929. You're live with Pastor Dow in Kentucky. Shalom.
Shalom. Shalom. Shalom, Pastor.
Shalom, Joe.
Can you hear me?
Yeah,
yes,
Junior, what you got?
You know, that's why I say I love y'all so much, man. I appreciate you sis doing a good job on the show. So, you know, y'all keep doing a good job, you know. You too, Pastor. I love y'all so much, man. Y'all have a blessed night. Shalom.
Hallelujah. Yes, sir. Thank you for the encouragement. Thank you for listening in. Shalom.
Shalom.
Hallelujah. Our faithful brother Junior. All right, y'all sisters keep calling in. Line them up. Erico 443 in Maryland. Looks like Sister Kelly. Let's go there. 443, you're live.
Shalom.
Shalom.
This is Sister Kelly.
Yes, ma'am. We can hear you well. Go ahead.
Hallelujah. I just want to say bless y'all. Thank you for everything. Calling up to Straightway and all the answers y'all give us when we have questions. Say bless you, Pastor. We all love you here in Maryland. I want to say shout out to Sister Jennifer for being here in Elder Rufus from last week. Had a beautiful time with them. Hallelujah. So that's all I got. I just want to say bless y'all. And that's all.
Hallelujah. Yes, ma'am. Thank you. I'm glad they got a chance to go out to the East Coast to see you.
Yes, ma'am.
All right,
thank you
shalom.
Very much. Y'all have a blessed night.
Hallelujah. You too. Thanks for listening. All right. Moving to the next one. Area code 210 in Texas. You're live on Sister to Sister.
Shalom. It's hello. Sister Crystal from
shalom. Hallelujah. Well, bless you. Bless you. What say you? You have a question for Pastor tonight?
No, ma'am. The daughter, ma'am, my daughter. I'm sorry. Shalom.
Hallelujah. You're a little choppy. Your phone connection's a little bad, but I think you were saying your daughters wanted to say shalom. So thank you for calling in. We love you, daughters.
Yes, ma'am. Bless you.
Bless you, Sister Crystal. All right. All right. Come on, Sister Melissa in Ohio. I know you got something. Hallelujah. You just came to my mind, so maybe you'll think of a question before the night's over. I want to lean to, oh, here we go. Area code 423. Got another one. 423, you're live on Sister to Sister with Pastor Dow.
Shalom, Pastor Dow. Blessing, Sister Ashley. Thank you so much, Pastor Dow, for being on the show tonight. This is Sister Jennifer. I just have a question.
Sure.
Hallelujah. We're ready. He's ready. Go ahead.
You know, you hear about the nature of women, and so much of it is rooted in wickedness. How do you teach us as women to hate the nature of a woman and not fall into self-hate and hate the fact that we were created a woman?
Well, that's pretty simple. Always, first and foremost, love Yah. Put him first. You know, when Yah created woman, he created a beautiful thing. He actually created woman to be, check this out, Adam's helpmeet. And our problem is today, especially with Israelite sisters, is that you've heard me make this statement before, that we've gone too far into this world. We have learned so much the way of the heathen that in our minds, we can't even fathom today to try to think like an ancient Israelite sister. Everything that I ever preach and teach and anything that I ever address when it comes to answering questions or ministering to the word, I always go back to the basis of the law and then work my way forward. And what we're doing today is we're, you know, women, sisters today, what I see is they're having a rough time and a struggle because they're coming from where we're at now rather than trying to unlearn everything that they had ever learned and start from the beginning over there in Bereshit and then see how the very character and the nature of our sisters should be. But if they love Yah, love his program, love exactly what he says, his laws, women would literally not have any problem. I know a lot of people find it a hard, you know, hard to believe, but Sister Carol used to be one of those independent American-type women. I know it's hard for people to believe it because we've been into this so long. I mean, we've been in this for a very, very long time. Sister Carol used to love being independent, doing things of the world, such as, you know, fashion, clothing and all this other stuff. The one thing I can say is she didn't spend too much time actually back talking and back speaking to me. And but you know, she had her ways, just like men have their ways. But it's the love of the Father and his love that will lead and guide you. And rather than despising the nature of a woman, despise the nature of the old woman, but love the new woman that is created new in Yahshua. Love the woman that is holy. Love the woman that wants to be sanctified. And just realize that the old Adamic nature is still there warring against the righteous woman, the holy woman that you desire to be. And then when you love the woman that is created in the Messiah, you'll despise the old nature and you'll hate the nature, but you won't hate yourself, because that's just the enemy trying to use reverse psychology on you. So always be encouraged, knowing that you're still in the fight, and never give up, because as long as you're breathing, that means you still have hope and your name is still written down.
Yes, sir. Thank you so much. Very good. Very practical. Thank you for being on the show tonight. Bless you all. Shalom.
Bless you and shalom. All right, no callers in the queue. I'm going to lean to my question, and if I don't have any more callers in the queue after my question, that's it, sisters. Come on. Now's your opportunity. So correct me if I'm wrong, Pastor, if I stated unclearly. It's been some time since I heard you speak, and it was just a statement that you briefly made in a preaching of how a man can teach a woman how to be a woman. Obviously, a woman can't teach a man how to be a man. We don't need that explanation. But how is it that, because a man can't think like a woman or feel like a woman, can't be a woman, how is it that he can teach her how to be a woman?
But I beg to differ. And the reason why I beg to differ is because of the pecking order that is laid out for us over in Genesis, the second chapter. You know, there's a patriarchal order. And then over in Paul confirms it in 1 Corinthians 11. And the reason why I say that, because Yah is the one who created all of us. And Yah expects us, starting from man up to Yah, he expects us to understand him, to love him, to obey him, and to have all of our desires towards him. Because this is a marriage covenant, it's a marriage relationship. In that, we are sensitive towards him. The same way that a woman should be sensitive towards a husband. We're very sensitive towards him. All of us have the Ruach. We know when we fall short of the glory of Yah. We know we've been tested, proven, and tried in a certain area. The same feeling that you sisters feel whenever you know you're missing the mark somewhere in the home or somewhere in your own life, we feel the same exact feeling. It's just a total different way because we're men and you're women. So remember I told us that we always walk in what we would call somewhat of a dual nature, because the men are also charged as being brides of Christ as well. You know, when we get into the kingdom, we're going to be the bride of Christ. All of us are. But the same role that you women, the women today, have to do in this world, in this sphere, in this realm that we're in now, the men are in that exact same role concerning Yahshua and Yah. Am I making any sense?
Absolutely.
So if we fall short of the glory of Yah or something like that, we can feel it. We understand where we're at. We deal with things at times where it seems like that he's putting more on us than we're able to bear. But the truth is we know that he's not putting more on us we're able to bear. It all has to do with our will to conform to him. Am I making any sense?
Yes, sir.
And so that's why I say that we can understand clearly. Even though we may be somewhat different in gender, and we are different in gender, but remember, from the very beginning, you all came out of us. And so therefore, that means that we know y'all better than what you think that we do. Now, the one thing that the Bible teaches over and over again, and it's not being disparaged, it's not even saying disparaging comments when I speak this way, but let me just go ahead and use a worldly sword. You ever heard this statement before? There is no wickedness like the wickedness of a woman. You ever heard that before?
Yes, sir.
You ever known this one before? Hell has known no fury like a woman scorned.
Yes.
You ever heard that before?
That's the word.
All that is in man.
Mm-hmm.
Every bit of that is in man to do the exact same thing. So we understand it. Hook, line, and sinker we do. It's just that we have a greater governor on us because we were created in the image of Yah.
Interesting.
If you understand what I mean. Whereas woman was created in the image of man. But going back to the very beginning, and I'm going to use this scripture right here to show you something right here in submissiveness.
Okay.
You know, this is one man serving another man over in Shemot 21, starting in verse 1. It says, now these are the judgments which thou shalt set before them. If thou buy a Hebrew servant, 6 years he shall serve, and in the seventh he shall go out free for nothing. If he came in by himself, he shall go out by himself. And if he were married, then his wife shall go out with him. Fourth verse, this is the one we'll capitalize on. If his master gave him a wife, notice here's the man that's coming to basically make himself an indentured servant, whether he owes his master something or whatever it is, whatever the debt is, he's indenturing himself to this particular master right here. So now we have a man submitting himself to another man, the same way we have that we as men have to submit to Yah, all right, and the same way that the woman has to submit to man, all right. If his master give him a wife, and she bore him sons and daughters, the wife and her children shall be her masters, and he shall go out by himself. The reason why I brought this up is to show that a man has the ability to submit to another man. And we know what submission means. A woman knows what submission means too, but because she is the weaker vessel, she is tempted greater to listen to the voice of the enemy and pay more attention to his voice because she believes that these thoughts originate from her own mind. These thoughts originate from her own volition. So until she understands the thoughts, the way that they were created and where they come from, and the way that she should be thinking, she's going to have a difficult time recognizing the voice of Yah as opposed to the voice of the enemy. But the law, the spirit, and the truth will always agree. And you can tell when you're in, you can tell when you're in order and you're in line with the word because your thoughts will always gender to peace. If your thoughts gender to confusion, if your thoughts gender to where there's a question if you should be doing this or shouldn't be doing that, the law is clear. The law is clear what you should be doing. The word is clear what you should be doing. That means anything is other than yea or nay, it is sin. And this is the trap that we fall into because sometimes we're trying to use our will, which is the will of the enemy, and mask it as Yah, and we have a difficult time submitting. So a man can really truly understand where a woman comes from, and he does, and he's sensitive to that woman because from the beginning she come out of him, and she was created from him, just like we were created from Yah, and we're very sensitive to him. And that's why whenever, you know, when you meet men of Yah, you ever notice that they're unwavering concerning, you know, a man loves a woman, his wife, right? And if you notice, a woman has a lot of influence on her husband. Is that correct?
Yes, sir.
But a strong man is going to be the one that's going to be able to discern and tell if the voice of what she's doing at this particular time, if it's something that is a legitimate need or this is a manipulation or something that she's trying to coerce and want. But, you know, that man, if he's any man of any worth whatsoever at all, he's going to stick right with Yah's program. Am I making any sense?
Perfect sense.
And that's why I say I beg different, and men do understand women. They understand them real good. And I think that that's a very good question, very good answer.
Absolutely. Yes, sir. Thank you so much.
What do you think?
Hallelujah. Sister Jordan's here tonight. Sister Bobby's here. Sister Lisa's here.
Am I making any sense? What do you think?
Me? I'm just listening, Pastor. I love the answer.
But you asked a question. I'd like to know what you think.
Because the information that you presented to me just now seals the deal, you know, and really just teaches me. I often wondered, I never doubted your statement when you preached it. I just didn't understand.
I'm going to tell you something here tonight. I'm going to say something here on this broadcast right now that I've never, ever, ever shared with anyone or ever said before. When I am in the pulpit preaching and teaching, I am so sensitive to every single woman in that congregation that my hollering, my screaming, my shouting has only one purpose, to scream so loud and to preach so hard that my voice becomes louder than the voices that are in your minds so that you will know what it means to eat of the fruit of the Spirit. I have so much compassion for y'all. It's just that in this world, we've been trained to think that if a man rises up, if he lifts up his voice, that he really truly don't care about me because we're dealing with emotions and feelings. But I am more sensitive to the sisters than I am the brothers in every single sermon. So if you hear me screaming, if you hear me hollering, or if it seems like that I'm going off and I'm really truly dealing with women really harsh, that's because of the great love that Christ has for the church,
right?
The Father has for the assembly, as well as his own son, as well as a husband for his wife, as well as a shepherd for his flock. Does that make any sense? So I'm really truly sensitive because I know what will happen when you bite on the fruit of truth, and I know what it will bring forth, the peaceful fruit of righteousness, when you grasp it and when you get it. Because, I mean, the truth is, the word is powerful. You can feel it. You can feel it in the foot. You know it's something spiritual behind it. You understand what I mean? But I'm a whole lot more sensitive to the sisters than I am the brothers. You get the analogy?
I get the analogy.
We are the assembly.
Yes.
We are the body of Christ. And he is the head. We're the neck and the rest of the body. Are you following me? And so the same thing, the way that Yah deals with us as with the assembly, is the same thing that is happening when a dynamic and the manifestations of preaching is going forth.
Hallelujah. Thank you for sharing that, Pastor. I could end the show, but I won't. Let's go to Tennessee, area code 615. You're live with Pastor Dow. Do you have a question?
Shalom, Sister Ashley. This is Sister Rachel. I'm sitting here with Mother Muncie listening, and we just wanted to thank Pastor for teaching us how to put the Most High first in all that we do as women.
Well, you're welcome. Hey, bless you, Mother Muncie. Love you. Love you dearly. Bless you, Sister Rachel. Hey, I do want all of... Go ahead, Mother.
I think I love you more, Pastor, because you don't know. I wish I would be 20 and learn like you teach us. Those young women don't know what kind of pastor they have, you know? And I understand as an old woman that the way that you talk is because you love us. So thank you.
Mother, with you and Mother Bullock, Mama Dow, I really, truly wish in this generation that I could have literally met. I wish I could be at the age I'm at now, and everybody else was 20 years old, and we could have 20 years of actually coming up in this, because the maturity level that we would be at. I mean, we already see the peace that we enjoy right now just by conforming to his image and being molded to Yah's image by obeying him. And if we could continue to keep on doing that, we would be light years ahead in holiness and where this generation is going. So, Mother, I do commend you, even where you're at right now and what you are, because you're such an example to the daughters of Zion. You and Mother Bullock, Mama Dow, all of y'all are meek, humble, quiet, but at the same time, very powerful. Your presence is very powerful. And the sisters and daughters respect y'all, and they should. And that is the type of holiness that we need in this time that we're living in order for the young daughters of Zion to know what a true mother is, because life has taught you all where you should be at today, and now you're doing everything you can in your power to make sure you teach the daughters coming behind you so that they can be a whole lot better than you ever could have been. So I do appreciate your service and your love, number one, to the Most High Yah, and him giving you the ears to hear and the submission to the ministry, as well as the community head down there, your son, Brother Al. It's just a beautiful, beautiful thing, and I wouldn't trade nothing for it in the world.
Thank you, Pastor. I just do it for him. He is my focus every day. Everything that I do, I just do it for the Most High. So that's all that I can do. Shalom, Pastor.
Shalom.
Shalom. You know, sisters, y'all labor is not in vain. Remember what I said. A man can really, truly understand your plight. They really, truly can. Because the same way that you have to submit to your husband, we have to submit to Yah. Am I making any sense? You see, you have somebody sitting in front of you that you can physically see. Whereas we don't see him, but remember the words of the Messiah. He told the Israelites, he said, blessed are your eyes because you see, but blessed are the eyes of the ones that have not yet seen, but yet they believe. So this thing is really, truly a big, gigantic love story. It really, truly is. And it's all about us destroying the way of the old man so that this new man, that the Ruach has actually given us the strength and the power to become, to come forth. And the church or the woman is the reflection of the assembly in the day that we're living in. That's why I'm honored. I often said it. Y'all heard me say it once. You heard me say it a thousand times. Straightway Community is at the best that it has literally ever been in the history of Straightway. And we're going on just on this land close to two decades. We've been on this land coming up on 18 years, if not 19. And this is the best. With all the people that's come through here that has actually lived here on this land, this is the best because the sisters that we have here, every single one of them strive for righteousness, strive for holiness, the brethren as well. And when I tell you that we have very little, I'm talking about 0.001% when it comes to indifference, contention, discord, it's literally almost non-existent here at this place.
It's true. Hallelujah. Mother Muncie, I just wanted to send a shout out to little Caitlin. She's doing wonderful. She looked wonderful, Mother.
Oh,
you weren't
she?
Here. Yes, you weren't here.
I said that to Brother Al, too. The same
really?
Thing.
Yes.
I said she looked strong.
Yes. So happy, so obedient. I had a blast with Sister Tamal when she was here, Mother. Just keep doing what you're doing. We love her dearly. So I had to shout out to Sister Caitlin, Daughter Caitlin. Let's go to Minnesota. Area code 763. You're live with Pastor Dow.
Shalom, Pastor. Shalom, Sister Ashley, Sister Evelyn.
Bless
Shalom.
You. How are you doing with that pregnancy there, Israel?
Oh, blessed, Pastor. I'm so blessed. We're blessed. I just have a quick question for Pastor.
Absolutely. He's listening.
Yes, Pastor. So, as you know, Day of Atonement is coming up, and I'm pregnant, and that day we're supposed to afflict our souls and fast all day, and I was wondering what sisters who have been pregnant in the past have done on that day.
Well, there's a lot of things they do in that day, but I tell you what you do. What you can do is you can drink water, you can make some smoothies. How about that?
Okay, hallelujah.
We got to take care of that seed.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. So drink water and smoothies.
Sure. It ain't nothing but 24 hours. Believe you me, 24 hours ain't nothing around here Straightway. I was just saying to Sister Carol when I came up, I said, it's already fifth day. I felt like I just got finished getting out of her first day. It's already fifth day. Isn't that the truth?
It's the truth.
This week is just like I blink is gone.
Hallelujah. Shabbat is not.
Hallelujah.
Anything else, Sister Evelyn?
No, ma'am. That was all. Thank you. Bless you, Pastor.
Bless you. Shalom, Israelite.
Shalom.
Hallelujah. Enjoy your smoothie. All right. Going to Georgia. It looks like Brother Mitch. Let's see if it is Georgia, Brother Mitch. Area code 706. You're live with Pastor Dow. Do you have a question?
Shalom, Pastor. Shalom, Sister Ashley. This is Sister Chandray.
Chandray, honored to hear from you, my sister, my friend. You are live. Go ahead. We can hear you very well. You have something for Pastor? Speak loud and clear so we all can listen to you.
Yes, ma'am. Pastor, bless you. This is regarding the message that you taught about restitution. That's Pastor Bot. How do you know that, or what are some of the signs of you paying restitution? You know, you talked about David, he paid back four for his one. Can you tell us some of the signs, how to recognize, or what are some of the signs that that we're paying back restitution?
Sure. Number one is peace. Number one is peace. Once you met Yah's condition, remember, everything in the covenant had to do first that which is natural. Now we're dealing with that which is spiritual. So don't we? You know, we're not going to negate the actual natural, but then we have that which is spiritual. But if you really truly look at it, and if people would really truly discern this, today people just really don't do evil just flat out in the open to each other like they did back then. It's these, all these sins of the soul, sins of the mind that goes on, if you understand what I mean. Am I making any sense?
Yes, sir.
When you make God's condition, you will experience peace. And you will have joy. You will have happiness. Now, is the enemy going to come and try to condemn you? You better believe. But see, once you've already done what you're supposed to do, it's up to you to accept the forgiveness. It's up to you to accept what Yah has already given you. Now, you can choose to be condemned if you want to. You heard me say it once and say it 1,000 times. I am sure. And now you know how difficult it is for us, being so righteous, to see the wrong that we've actually done to us. I mean, after all, how many times I said, use the example of a manila pad. You write your little transgressions on this side, you write everybody else's on this side, and you're going to always find out that the people who have done you wrong is greater than what you have done. All right? So with that knowledge and with that wisdom and knowing that, all right, just knowing that in general, once we met God's conditions, we'll experience peace and we will walk in the newness of life and there's no condemnation. You don't have to sit there and try to appease someone once you've already met God's conditions. You need to get strong enough to know that you have met the conditions, whether they believe it or not. Am I making any sense? Because too many times we put in the focus and we watch people instead of, you know, discerning the spirits, we watch what they do. We watch how they respond. We watch how they react. And then we base everything on how they do, how they respond, and how they react. If you have met the conditions to make sure that they're at peace, when the truth is, the focus is, you should be at peace once you met y'all's conditions.
Yes, sir. I understand. Yes, sir.
See,
thank
you've
you.
Already paid it. Am I making sense? You've already paid it.
Yes, sir. All right. Thank you very much.
You want me to contrast that with David?
Yes, please. Go ahead.
The scripture says that the only thing that Yah remembered with David was one matter, and one matter only. Save only in the matter of Uriah the Hittite. Did you hear that?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Now, notice, Yah remembered that, but he didn't mention anything else by any of the other prophets. Do you know why?
Why?
The reason why, because the only thing we can ascertain from this is because in this matter right here, as far as the murder of Uriah, he never did even repent for. But he did repent for the adultery. He did repent for other things. But remember, Yah said in his word, I will separate your sins as far as from the east to the west. I'll throw them into the depths of the sea, never to remember again. How is it that in the scripture it brings up only one matter? I mean, David sinned and numbered Israel, and 70,000 Israelites was murdered, killed, dead. But Yah said, in every point of David's life, in every aspect of his life, he met his conditions, he did everything was right, save only in the matter of Uriah the Hittite. Now think about that for a second. That means there's hope for us that even if we fail to repent for something that we didn't quite understand, that Yah, grace and mercy, still will extend past that. It will overshadow that. His blood will cover. Isn't that a beautiful thing?
Beautiful. Yes, sir, that is.
That's why I always say it's the goodness of Yah that leads thee to repent. Do it feel good to repent? No, I don't feel good to repent, but it sure is his goodness that leads us to repent. And in that, we need to say hallelujah and thank you.
Yes, sir. So would that kind of be like an example of all of you wanting your sins to go before you and not come afterwards? But that's one that basically is going to come after. Would that be an example of that too?
Okay. Yes. Well, sins, confess, when I say the sins going forward, like it's spoken about over in what they call, quote unquote, the pastoral letters. That's being Christian right there. I'm just joking around, all right? But anyway, that's sins that you confess going forward. And when they are going forward, your slate is clean. I know it's hard for us to believe. It's hard for us. But we have to believe that Yah is just. He is faithful. And he is just. That if we confess our sins, he is faithful. And he is just. That he would forget all of our sins and he would cleanse us of all unrighteousness. Did you hear that?
Yes, sir.
And because Yah loved David, he loves you too. Did you know that Yah loves you just as much as he loves David?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
No, you did know that.
Pastor, because I know he loves me. And, Pastor, I'm telling you, sometimes when you're sitting, you're on Blog Talk, I know it was one particular time. I mean, there's a lot of times where I've just seen his love through you, but one time you were on Blog Talk and you just said, I love my people and I love Israel. And Pastor, I'm telling you, it was like the Father was just standing there, or you were just standing there right in front of me, and I could just feel his love. So yes, and you know, so yes, I know that. I know that Yah loves me and I know that you love me. So I do. I really do.
From that point, all you have to do is accept it and walk in a newness of life. I mean, I'm in this radio room and these sisters, I ain't even got started good, and all they've been doing is crying the whole time.
Y'all crying too out there, Mother Jaja. You crying, Mother. Yeah, you are.
That's all they doing, man. I'm about to get flooded in here.
I don't blame them. I'm tearing up too.
That's because,
yes,
see,
sir.
This is a little bit more personal and up close because people don't get to hear this side. They don't get to hear this side, and they think this side is non-existent. But remember, behold the goodness and the severity of Yah. Remember, he hates a false balance. He's that way both ways. Am I making sense?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
I'm on a sister's broadcast. If I was on a brother's broadcast, I would let them have it.
Amen, Pastor. They need it, Pastor. You need to talk to them brothers, Pastor. You got to get on them in, Pastor. Bless you, Sister Chandra. We love you. That was a very good question. Anything else, Sister, from Georgia?
I did have one more question. You know, the letter that talks about confessing your sins one to another.
Yes.
At what point or how do you know when you should confess your sins one to another? If that makes sense.
How do you know?
Or when? Well, if you have an aught with your brother or if you've done something to someone, I know you would, you know, confess to them or something. But, I mean, just the word says, you know, confess your faults one to another and pray for one another. I mean, when do you, I guess when you're just sometimes just talking how do you know when to confess your faults to your brethren or... Am I making sense or am I just...
You're making sense
not,
to me. You know the reason. Do you know the reason why you're making sense to me?
Why?
Because you walk such an impeccable way in life and that you try to always, and ever since I've known you, you've always tried to make sure you never crossed anyone, you never said anything evil against anyone. So you're having difficulty trying to find out, okay, where have I sinned? Because if I sin, I want to get it right. And if you have practiced and walked the majority of your days that I have known you since repentance and making sure you meet Yah's conditions, it's very difficult for you to zero in on how do I know that I've actually trespassed? How do I know? Of course, you know, it's by the knowledge of the law, by the knowledge of truth. And that's the reason why you're having a difficult time trying to frame the question and stuff because And let me go this route, too, also. Sister, there are people that will flat-out test you. They will try you. and they will make you think that you are the problem and you are the issue. Are you listening to me?
Yes, sir.
And a righteous woman will always search her heart. She will always look into her soul first. And what your problem is that you're looking for peace on something that's not giving you peace, which is to establish a solid relationship against with the one that is transgressing against you. Are you hearing me?
Yes, sir.
With some people, the bottom line is because of maturity, you just simply can't have peace with. A long time ago, I preached a message about don't be a doormat for everybody. Am I making sense?
Yes, sir.
Just because somebody is not at peace and you have already made y'all's condition, don't you own what they have. Don't you even act like you even own what they have, or you even take ownership of it and feel like you're condemned because they are not doing better. Is that making sense?
Yes, sir.
Some people are so evil that they are not seeking so much peace that they want to continue to keep heaviness and a burden on top of you just so you'll feel like that you are the problem itself. I wouldn't play that game. I'll pick up my ball and I'll go home.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I understand. Thank you very much.
Well, you're
bless
welcome.
Y'all.
Oh, bless you.
And I love y'all. Bless y'all, sisters, all scattered abroad. Shalom.
Shalom, shalom. Calls are lining up. Keep them rolling, sisters. The show is up to you. Area code 484, Pennsylvania. Shalom, you're alive. I'm sister to sister.
Shalom, this is Sister Ayana. Shalom, Pastor. Shalom, sisters.
Shalom.
I didn't have a question. I did want to say thank you to Pastor when he said that, you know, he talks the way he talks in the pulpit so he can, you know, overpower some of the spirits that we hear in our minds. And I know that they can be very outrageous at times, so I just want to say thank you for him being such a strong man of Yah and being such a strong vessel to the point where it makes my flesh so uncomfortable that I have to follow the Spirit. And which I want to do, but, you know, I fall short. So I wanted to say thank you.
Well, you're welcome. Just remember this. It's never personal. The only time that when I'm preaching and teaching, it gets personal is because I want everybody to strive for righteousness. But it's never, ever, ever a personal issue with myself and any individual. It's all about exalting Yah's kingdom.
Yes, sir. Bless you. And Sister Leah is here as well.
Yes, ma'am. Go ahead.
Shalom, shalom, sisters and pastor.
Shalom.
Hey, shalom. Leah, how old are you?
I'm 15.
That's what I thought. You know, I got brothers already asking about you.
Yes, sir.
I sure do. I got brothers that already got their eyes on you. You must be doing something right, sister.
Hallelujah.
Better be doing something right. You had better. Hallelujah.
What you got, Olivia?
Nothing. I just wanted to say shalom and thank you guys for everything you do.
Well, shalom.
Hallelujah. Shalom.
Bless you guys.
Bless you. Didn't mean to cut you off. Going to Texas now. Shalom. Area code 281. You're live on Sister to Sister with Pastor Dow.
Shalom, shalom. Blessing to you, Pastor Dow, Sister Ashley. Bless you with Sister Nastasha. How are y'all?
Very well.
Doing well.
Hallelujah. Bless the Father. Pastor Dow, thank you for all your wisdom, and thank you for all that you do during the messages. I'm very grateful. It's helping me strive to show a pattern of good works. May I ask a question, please?
Yes, ma'am. We're ready. Go ahead. We can hear you loud and clear.
Hallelujah. This is kind of a two-part question, spiritual and physical. Pastor Dow, I injured my back at Home Depot between this past December and January. The result of that injury was muscle tension, and I've been studying muscle tension in the spirits of pride, Leviathan, you know, the yoke around our neck, the curses that come from Deuteronomy 28. Pastor, can you maybe guide me on maybe what is going on in my muscles? Because I'm in the process of repentance, going to others that I have sinned against, and also forgiveness from others and forgiveness of myself. Do you have any wisdom when it comes to muscle pains in the back that maybe
I sure do.
Like, yes, sir.
Got a whole bunch of them. Sister Lisa, come here. Now, the reason why I'm calling Sister Lisa in here, I want to show y'all how that even though I'm a pastor and even though I'm the leader of the ministry and stuff, I know how to default to other Israelites who have more of insight in reference to certain situations, because you're dealing with a natural aspect that you're trying to bring it over to the spiritual when it's something that took place natural. So Sister Lisa is going to address your situation.
Bless you, Sister Nastasha.
Bless you.
Can you
sister.
Hear me? Actually,
yes,
you don't. You all don't know this, but Sister Nastasha and I have been communicating for several days and many hours. So I've actually given her everything physical.
Well, tell everybody.
Tell everybody.
Tell everybody, because everybody's listening.
Tell everybody what her program is that I had her to do.
You ought to do a program. Just tell everybody what her issue is and some of it, what they had to do, because the other people are listening.
What would we do if we had fallen at Home Depot and hurt our back, Sister Lisa?
Okay, so Sister Nastasha got a hold of me and was basically telling me what she's explained to all of you, and she actually had gotten some counsel from another sister, Sister Kiara, and she was doing a lot of the right things, and she was actually, Sister Nastasha had done her homework. She was looking into what muscles and what spirits, like she just conveyed to you all. And so we came up with some additional things. I gave her a program just basically of, and I won't go into minutes or times or amounts, but basically in her particular case with what she explained was going on without getting completely personal, we talked about having her first do a program that started with moist heat, and then I would have her do stretches, and then I would have her get massage, and then I would have her do some deep tissue stuff like with a Theracane, which is an apparatus that you can utilize on yourself to get into spots that are hard to reach and that you need to get in deeper with. I also told her, how to use a tennis ball and end with ice. And then we went over the program as she gets better, what strengthening exercises to do. And I want to say from the natural aspect, she is doing everything. She would check with, I told her, check in with me, so she would call me periodically every few days. We talked for quite at length, you know, 45 minutes here, 20 minutes there, and she was progressing, and I said, okay, what else? And she was telling me what work techniques she's doing at work, and we'd go over how to do better body mechanics, her posture, et cetera, looked at things like shoes, whatnot. So she was actually doing all that, and at the same time researching the spirits like she just brought to your attention, Pastor. So
now if you have met all those conditions and you still having somewhat what we will call annoyances and continual problems, then you have nothing more than just rebellion, old-fashioned rebellion, because the enemy has to have legal grounds, legal rights, and sometimes it can mask itself in an injury when it's really, truly, spiritually, your attitude. The way you carry yourself, the what you do in your life. Old-fashioned rebellion and stubbornness. So I'm going to admit all these natural conditions, then you have the spiritual. Because I'm going to tell you flat out, Sister Lisa's right. If people will just stick in being faithful to what you should be doing naturally, and if it doesn't alleviate from that point, then the spiritual problem is nothing but rebellion and nothing but stubbornness.
Yes, sir. Hallelujah. Thank you. I greatly appreciate it. I greatly appreciate your wisdom, and thank you, Sister Lisa, as well. Bless you. It's a great broadcast. And shalom.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you, Sister Lisa. Wait, Lisa, before you go, why would Pastor call you in and ask you anything, and how would you know what in the world you're talking about, my sister?
I'm sorry. I actually have been an occupational therapist for 25 years and have worked in a variety of different places like rehab hospitals, acute hospitals, outpatient hospitals. I've done ergonomics and things like that, so I've been able to help some of the saints with the more natural stuff where that comes in. So,
hallelujah. Very good answer. Thank you so much.
I mean, the shepherd knows his sheep.
Right, and she knows what she's talking about. Hallelujah. All right. Hallelujah. Thank you, Sister Natasha. Let's go to New York, New York, to the newlyweds. Sister Esther, shalom, you're live with Pastor Dow. What say you?
Shalom, shalom, Sister Esther. Shalom, Pastor.
Shalom, Sister Esther. Have you ever seen that picture of you and I where our back is to the camera? You ever seen that?
Yeah, I have.
I've got the
Sister Alasia give me a copy of it.
Man, I got to get that thing blowed up or whatever and stuff because that's a classic.
It is. Thank you, Pastor. I have a two-part question. One of them has to do with work. One of the things that I want to know, Pastor, is how do I guess working with in a heated environment and working with other people who are not in the faith, who some just don't believe. And there's one particular colleague that I have who is a homosexual. So, but her and I, we have to work together because she's in my team. So my interaction with her is very, I don't know, like normal. And I guess I want to know, how do I stay sober knowing that, you know, her lifestyle is an abomination to the Father, but yet I don't, like, her and I, as far as when it comes to interaction-wise, like, we have very good dynamic. Like, other teachers, they gossip, they slander her. She's just very straightforward. She tells you what it is. And it's like, I don't know. I'm trying to find a balance. So I don't know what counsel can you give, Pastor, regarding that.
Well, think about this, sister. The best example that we can always use in the Word is Joseph. You remember Joseph?
Yes, sir.
Joseph went through many trials, many tribulations. And Yah always blessed him through each and every last one of them because his righteousness was centered and focused upon him obeying the commandments of Yah. Most people think that the commandments wasn't even there at the time of Joseph. When you think about it, how in the world could this man end up second in command and then have his name changed to Zephaniah over Mizraim if he didn't end up pleasing Yah and was able to provide a deliverance for his people? You, all you have to do is this. Do your job. This person has a problem with homosexuality, but man, I know it's out front, it's in the open, but what about the person that is a saint that's sitting next to you that's got a problem with slander? Which one is the greater abomination? Am I making any sense?
Yes, sir.
In other words, don't get in and fall into the religious trap. You be an example of a believer, and you will see how Yah will bless you. Hey, hopefully, that she'll be end up being convicted and turn from that lifestyle because of the way that you are. As long as you can get along with her and she ain't preaching to you, her abominable lifestyle and stuff, but you're being an example, there is a Holy Spirit, there's a Ruach that will convince her and convict her of her situation. But you, just like Joseph, you got to live for Yah.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Pastor. I guess the other part of the question is,
hey, I'll tell you this, homosexuals don't disturb me at all. Now, I had to mature in this letter. I had to mature big time. Not that I'm acquiescing because I hate homosexuals. I hate the spirit. Are you following me? Those people are still alive. Did you hear what I said? I hate the spirit, but those people are still alive. I have not ever saw them or caught them in the act of actually committing acts of homosexuality. Am I making any sense?
Yes, sir.
Neither have I ever seen one that has ever tried to offend me. Y'all's the judge. Am I making sense?
Yes, sir.
But if you try to come into this assembly with your homosexual spirit, if you try to play an instrument or want to be in part of the leadership, or you understand? Am I making sense now?
Yes, sir, you are.
You are light. You are light to that world, sister. No doubt about it. Mm-hmm. And as long as there's breath in that body, you can actually do something by your conviction and your holiness to be able to show that what they're doing is wrong. And then maybe they'll open up their mind and their heart because they'll see your chaste conversation and they'll want to know what you know.
Mm-hmm. All right. Thank you, Pastor. I guess the other part of the question that goes hand in hand is how to stay sober and I guess spiritually lifted in the environment where it's like very busy at work and there's just so many things going on and you find yourself like not being sober around you. So what counsel can you give and how to stay sober in a workplace where it's not, you work with other, you know, heathens and stuff?
Paul says we make songs and we do hymns and make melodies in our heart. That's what we do. In other words, in our mind. As long as he's the center of focus and attention of everything that we're doing in our life, there ain't nothing that can distract you, and there's nothing that can steal your joy unless you give it over to it.
I receive that. Thank you, Pastor.
Shalom.
Thank you. That's all I have. Shalom.
Hallelujah. I want to stay right there for a second, Pastor, because so many come so zealous, so religious, so spiritual, and they're still working out there. It's a very good question, Sister Esther. I appreciate it. I want to hear even more from you, Pastor, on how to divide the flesh from the spirit, because like you said, that is a spirit. And I think we could preach to them. We could share, the gospels with them. We could do all those wrong things to draw people and make a lot of mistakes in our work environments or places that we're around the heathen. So how would you instruct someone behaviorally to interact? Because you have a very good friendship with the few friends that you have that are not righteous men. So how do you instruct those that are brand new, Pastor?
Christianity has taught us that we need to go out and win souls. And the Bible says he that wins a soul is wise. Well, the only wise one is the Most High Yah. People act like, that I've never been out in the world before myself. I was in the military. Not only in the military, I was in the elite part of the military. Now it gets even more crazy, if you understand what I mean. Because the only law there is just straight up sin, if you understand. So, military, going to the private sector, is that private sector? That's civilian sector, it's not private. Private would be if you own a business, wouldn't it?
Civilian?
Yeah.
Civilian, private.
Okay, going to the civilian sector. Think about this for a second. When I was a soldier, all I did was be an example. Because I already knew the mindset where these guys come from. I've been there. But I know that they have never had the experience where I'm at. Am I making sense?
Yes.
And in that, I was able to draw a lot of people to the assembly. Not because I preached to them over and over and over again. I didn't go and say, well, you're breaking a commandment. You're not subject to the commandments. You're not subject to the law. You don't even want to hear the law.
Right.
You understand what I mean?
Right.
Your conviction is coming based upon the light that you see emanating from me. Not because I'm preaching to teach you the word, because I'm not doing that. If you come and ask me about the word, then I will tell you. Why are you this way, brother? Why you do this? Why you do that? Well, brother, let me set you down here and let me tell you the reason why. See, we're so overzealous. We're so religious nowadays. And we still have the residue of the Christian Gentile mind on us where we think that we got to preach and teach to everybody and stuff rather than letting our lifestyle be the greatest preaching and teaching of all. In other words, be an example. Is that amazing?
Yes, sir.
Think about Jesus. He saw, I spoke about it a few Sabbaths ago. He saw a woman at a well.
Mm-hmm.
He didn't talk to her about no eternal life. He talked to her about if you knew who it was and the gift that he had for you, you would be asking of me. He talked to her personally about her. No, you ain't never had one of them. You had five of them.
Mm-hmm.
And the one you got now is not even yours. You see what I mean?
Yes, sir.
He talked to the centurion. He talked to the woman of Canaan. He when you go read all the things that Messiah did, he was meeting people right where they were, and then all of a sudden, because of his benevolence, because of the way he carried himself, the people would ask questions to him, then he would open up, and then he would explain and expound, and then would he expose and tell them. You get that?
Absolutely, yes, sir.
He won't go out there browbeat everybody.
And he sure didn't bring out the Torah.
No, he didn't bring out. How you going to condemn somebody ain't even subject to the law and make them subject to the law that they ain't subject to? All you going to do is run them off. He lived, and his light was an example. And because he is the light, the people came. Because they were in darkness, they come to the light.
Yes, sir. Very good. Very, very good. Keep calling, sisters. We broke our first hour with Pastor Dow. We appreciate his time. We're going to Ohio. Area code 614. You're live. What say you?
Shalom, Sister Ashley. Shalom, Pastor Dow. This is Sister Melissa.
Sister Melissa. Yes. Bless you. We can hear you loud and clear. You have a question for Pastor?
Oh, that's good, because I'm... yes, ma'am. I'm on the house phone. I was like, oh, man, I'm on the phone with Mother Beasley on the three-way so we can listen in together. But I have permission, first of all, to speak with you, sir. So I have a question. Pastor, because we have proof of your anointing, the assembly is proof of your pastorship. There is no doubt that you are a Jeremiah 3:15. And for that reason, I ask, where do you see the truth of polygyny taking us, Yah's people, spiritually and naturally, sir?
Well, it can only take us one place. It can only take us to a place that Yah has already ordained, which is closer to him. It's going to cause us to be more separated, more set apart, but also more sanctified. And the reason being is because in the Gentile world, it's such a stumbling block before them that their pride or whatever else they got in front of them, whatever speed bumps they have in front of them, will not allow them to overcome that obstacle. But everyone that can actually humble themselves under the Yah's program. I mean, I got a debate coming up with a pastor that wants to debate me on polygyny and stuff, and I guarantee you he's going to lose hands down. But it's just Yah's ordained pattern. When you look at Matityahu, the 25th chapter, verses 1 through 13, you see he talks about five wise and five foolish. What is that speaking about besides five wise and five foolish? We know it was 10 virgins. Is that correct? Sure we do. But five were wise, five were foolish. The foolish actually knew where to go to buy in order to get enough oil in their lamps. They knew they had to go to the wise. Am I making any sense thus far? In other words,
ma'am.
People know it's right. They know it's the truth. They know what's going on. It's something bigger than what meets the eye. Now, let's go from the natural perspective and point of view. All right? What is the purpose of polygyny or multiple wives in the time that we're living in now? I'll tell you the reason why. You look at us as Israelites, how few we are in number in the land of our captors. What is the doctrine and what is the order of a conquering nation when it goes into another nation? Well, the first thing to do is to eliminate all opposition, to make sure that their numbers are decimated so that they never will be able to rise up and oppose you. That's war. That's coming from the tactics of war. Let's skip over to Shemot over in the time of the Exodus. When we went out of the land of Canaan into the land of Goshen, we only went into that place 70 people. Some people say it's 430 years. I'm going to do a teaching here before long that we were not in captivity 430 years, but we were in the geographical location 430 years. When I bring the numbers to bear, you're going to be able to see how that in a very short period of time, we came in 70 and we left out 600,000 fighting men. That's not including women and children. In other words, there's strength in numbers, there's power. Even though Yah told Gideon, you got too many, the nations are afraid of Yah's laws, y'all's statutes and y'all's commandments, being rich and ruling on this earth based on the amount of people that will support his law. That's the natural standpoint and the perspective of it. Coming from the other side, it's nothing but the devil that's causing a genocide, both naturally and spiritually, upon the minds of the people to actually be against something that God sanctified. Yah is actually regulated. Not only did he regulate, he actually made provision for. He told a woman that if you died, or if your husband died and he didn't have any seed that was raised up, it was a command. It was a directive according to the law that you would actually go to your husband's brother to raise up seed. Yah, who can't alter and change anything that has gone out of his lips, told David, the king, a man created right after his own heart, that if you would have wanted more, in other words, besides Bathsheba, Uriah, the Hittite's wife, I would have given to you. You see, so whenever he spoke or whenever he speaks, he doesn't say everything that needs to be said. I think it's all about influence of power and structure. The powers that be in the time that we're living in, they do not want us to rise up as a great nation by outnumbering them with our numbers. That's the real true attack against polygyny today.
Yes, sir. Bless you. Thank you so much, Pastor.
Yes, ma'am.
Very Shalom. Good question, too. Shalom. Hallelujah. Thank you all for your questions. Every one of them have been very good. Hallelujah. We're going to the dining hall, area code 615. Looks like Mother Barb. Let's see if it is. Shalom.
Yes, ma'am. Shalom, Sister Ashley. Shalom, man of Yah. Bless you, Pastor Dow.
Shalom.
Bless you, Sister Ashley. Pastor, just had a question on spiritual maturity and also deliverance.
Hey, hold on one second, Sister Barb. I got something I want to ask you, all right?
Yes, sir.
Sister Barb, let me see.
Yes,
you've been on this community how many years?
12 years now, Pastor.
12 years. All right. Watch this. I want everybody to listen to this and listen very closely. Sister Barb, when was the last time that I actually came up and struck a conversation with you?
Pastor, it does not happen very often. Maybe you might pass by my table and mention something. If we've watched a video or something, you might make a comment. But as far as striking up a conversation, I cannot pull that up, sir.
Utterly amazing, isn't it?
Amazing.
In other words, this morning I spoke to you about the teenagers in homeschool. Is that correct?
Yes, sir.
The reason why I'm saying this right now, it's because people don't understand community. I'm trying to develop a picture. And I'm trying to let people see and understand this, that the sisters, they're doing their thing. The brothers are doing their thing. And it's very rare that we even carry on conversations. And I'm the pastor. You understand what I mean? It's very rare that we even carry on conversations. Is that true, Sister Barbara?
Yes, sir, it is.
All right, well, go ahead with your question.
Yeah, that's one of the reasons I called, Pastor. I was looking at an old newsletter today. I was searching for something, and I came across a 2004 newsletter. And you had a really nice article about communities, and you also had a very nice, probably about maybe a paragraph or more, on what we should be doing as far as food storage and saving up items for a future time that was going to be coming upon us. And it was really amazing to look at what you were saying then compared to what you're still saying now. It's just right on plumb line. And what I wanted to mention, Pastor, before I ask you about spiritual maturity and deliverance, I met you in 1998. I was still in my 30s. And I began to fellowship with you and several communities that we were associated with at that time. And the very first time that I got to come and stay on the community was in 2001. And I got to the privilege of staying here for a night at the community in Tennessee. And I also got to stay at another community that was run at the time, and still is as far as I understand, by David Roberts. It was Victory Community. So I got to stay here for 2 days, and I got to stay there for about 5 days, and it was during the Feast of Tabernacles. So I got to, the very first time I ever stayed at a community, I got to get a feel of your community and also another person's community. And since the time, Pastor, I have really watched you, and I've not really watched as closely other pastors, because I tend to believe what you have taught is that we shouldn't go to other tables, and I base my principle on that, on Ruth. When Ruth was talked to by Boaz, he told her to stay in his fields, and I always felt that the Father pressed that very strongly on me before I ever really heard you talking about don't eat off other tables. I knew that I was to stay with you, that the Father had given me that understanding. But what's interesting, Pastor, is to watch the spiritual maturity that has come upon you, and not only you, but all that have been associated with your ministries and have stayed with you. And I look at the other communities, and I see the kind of attack right now that you're currently under. It's not a new attack for you, sir, because I've watched over the years, there's been many things that have tried to come up and taint your character and taint the community and taint the people that are associated with your community. But having known you, Pastor, for 17 years, I just want to testify a moment to your character and to your standards here at the community. And just before I do that, if you don't mind, I'd like to just give a little bit of understanding of who I am and my character. I went to school and became a school librarian media specialist. That took 17 years of my time. And after that, I ended up graduating with a master's degree in library science, and I began to teach in public schools. I taught in elementary, middle, and high school libraries. And I also worked in a law library, a university library, and some other evening libraries that would be a technical library. So I've had a lot of experience, and that was over a 10-year period. Then after that, I stayed home and became a stay-at-home mother and a homeschool mother. So that was about a 10-year period. And during that time, I began to fellowship with you and learn the material that the Father would have provided through your ministry. And I just want to speak to your character, Pastor. In all the times that I have known you, and since moving out here, I moved out here around 2005, since moving out here, your character, sir, is very, I always like to use an impeccable, and your character is steadfast, plumb line. There is no immorality that I've seen with you at all, sir. And so by going up, having Sister Kathy and another member of our community talked to in the way that we recently heard the character of not only her, but you and her children spoken against, I would like to say that is a total falsehood. I've never seen anything like that. You've been always respectable, not only to your wife. You've had a very loving relationship with her. I've watched your love and her love grow together. It's just been an absolute joy to watch people that are married that do enjoy themselves and actually spiritually grow together. And so I just want to speak a moment to that, Pastor, and having, you know, somewhat of a credential out in the world. I'm not just somebody that has not seen professional people, seen characters, working in a library, you learn people. You see all kinds of different characters. You meet lots of different parents. You see a lot of spectrum. And I just want to thank you for your diligence. I want to thank you for all your hard work. And I just want to speak to your community and to your character that you have really developed a large amount of people who are still following you and have an impeccable character. And thank you for the compliment on the people that are still with you, and especially here at the community that we are also growing with you. And so, anyway, I just wanted to put that little plug in and just tell you that I thank you for all things. And my question is, on that spiritual maturity, when I look at the differences between people that are actually growing and people that are stagnant, the one thing that seemed to stand out to me was the religious spirit. And with that, Pastor, my question is on deliverance. When a person is so entrenched with a religious belief or a religious spirit that it's like you mentioned, I think, today, and when you think like a bigot, where their prejudiced mind will not change over and they don't want to transform. What can we do for that situation if we find that there are people that we're really still trying to pray for and we're trying to get help for? What spiritually can we do to reach out, and what do we do if we find ourselves like that?
One thing I'm finding out, one thing I'm thinking about, Sister Barbara, is this. After the first and second admonition, really, truly, I mean, we can't go past the book. You have to reject. You literally have to reject. And the reason why you have to reject is because the people, they have a will. And their will, because of religious spirits, is stronger than righteousness. A religious spirit wants Yah and everybody else that surrounds it to acquiesce to it in order for it to feel like that Yah is going to give them the answer. That's pretty much basically it in a nutshell. Addressing other things, unsolicited, I do appreciate what you said. When you do look at it, and we go back to 2004, 2005, you look at some of the people that we were associated with, every one of them had went on a very steep decline, which I would call the spirit of Ichabod. The glory of Yah has departed from them, while we have done nothing but increase and continue to increase, continue to affect positive change in people's lives. Most people are so blinded because of the spirit of Leviathan and what they've got into them that they just cannot ever admit that somebody has actually done proven to be more anointed. It's kind of like Saul, Saul and David. Saul got anointed by Yah. He turned around and ended up, being discredited, being disproved by Yah because of his lackadaisical attitude towards the law. Samuel went to turn around to anoint David. Found a man out of his own heart. I guess that pretty much would fit me because there was one guy who was 30 years my senior, another guy was 11 years my senior, and no matter how much they holler, scream, huff, and puff, they don't literally have any anointing in them whatsoever at all. As a matter of fact, everything has done decline in their ministry, and everything with us has done, past quadruple, Sister Ashley, since you've been here, because you've been around a while.
Yes, sir, and I have to tell all of you, sisters, you didn't know Pastor and I's relationship prior to, me now, I have a covering, I have a head that I follow, Brother Doug Bell. You didn't know that I came in like unto a daughter to Pastor.
Still all my daughters.
Absolutely.
You just married and got two children now.
Right. and really what I'm testifying to, Pastor, because you asked Sister Barb, how much do I talk to you? When I became betrothed and was to be wed, he would often remind me, that when you take, this vow, this covenant, when you make this covenant with this man, I will not be talking to you the way that I'm speaking to you. I will not
remember that.
I remember it so well that I, are you kidding me? Do I remember that? I told Jordan just recently, because Jordan is a daughter unto Pastor, and she teared up because she knows she will hear the same words in the future. But yeah, it was very real to me to hear, I'm no longer going to talk to you or interact with you as a daughter, but you will be a married woman. This is the character of Pastor Dow. So, anything else on that note?
No, that's true. I'm surprised you remember that.
Yes, sir.
You remember that?
Never forget
that. I mean, think about it. You used to go everywhere with us.
Everywhere.
I mean, everywhere, ministry trips, doing everything. I'm serious.
One time, you were headed to South Carolina, and I got in the back seat and waited until the car cranked. And he went to turn, and go reverse. Him and Sister Carol were in the front, and there I was, cheesing. I didn't have no bags. It was just as a joke, like, aren't you going to take me? He's like, what the hell? Get out of the car. It's like 6 a.m. in the morning, That was kind of our relationship, like, aren't you going to take me with you, Pastor? But anyway, at one time I even put a picture of me on the dash, like, here I go. But, yeah, that was me and him. So, things change. But that's the pastor you're looking at, you're talking to one of great respect and reverence to the man first.
And just because things have changed, if you really truly look at it, think about it though. Who is probably one of the most instrumental sisters in the ministry? Sister Ashley is. Sister Broadcast, she's the host. Who's the one to do the reading? Up in the Shabbat, you understand what I mean? Who's the one, besides Sister Carol, is more instrumental in deliverance than any sister in the entirety of Straightway. Sister Ashley is. So, whereas she may not be up under my wing and be around me the whole time and stuff, she still is recognized as an honorable sister because I see her labor of love.
Hallelujah. Bless you, Pastor. You know, many of us, you often hear, sisters, the dining hall chats. Mm-hmm. And I know you're still on Mother Barb, so don't go anywhere. The dining hall chats are often spoke of, and how you all miss them. That's Nehemiah in the background. Sister Bobby's watching him tonight. So we used to hear prophetic things, you know, from a man that will never, unless Yah shows him to be a prophet, he will never proclaim to be a prophet. That's not anything that he's never ever said, but he operates in such a gift of prophecy that since the day that I moved here, I have heard so many innumerable things come to pass that have been spoken a lot in private to the disciples here. I wrote a few of them down, not only just the silver and the food shortage that's coming, because some of these things you haven't seen, Daughters of Zion, you haven't seen them come to pass yet. But I know from his impeccable record of prophecy and operating in that spirit that it's going to happen. Political victories, he prophesies of cop kills. That was years ago that he said cops are going to be dying in the streets. Brethren that are falling away, he always knows beforehand. Everything that's happening now, he knows beforehand. One of the huge ones was the race war. I've been here 9 years, and literally from the time that I moved here 9 years ago, I've heard about that in dining hall chats where you white people, and he's talking about a color. We know it to be a nation now, but just in reference to what he's speaking to, white people, your own are going to turn on you. You know, this will be, in the end, there's going to be a race war. He would always talk about these things. So I, too, testify of his impeccable character and operating under a spirit of prophecy that nothing on earth would minister to you like this gift of Yah could. Only Yah knows futuristic things and demons as well. But this man is truly anointed, and I appreciate that. Mother Barb, anything else on that note?
No, ma'am, Sister Ashley. I just did want to say just one other comment, and then I will be getting off and letting someone else get on the call queue. Just that I did pull up just to look and see what the community that, one of the other communities we were associated with looked like, and it really did not look like ours. We are such a lively group. We're a lively stones, and I just thank Pastor for that. And Ashley, thank you for all you do. And Pastor was right on. It's been a joy watching you also grow, and you are definitely growing into mature womanhood with a very good record of a lot of blessings from the Father. So keep on doing what you're doing. And thank you, Manny, y'all, for being with us tonight. Shalom.
Shalom.
Hallelujah.
Hey, I got 2 grandchildren out of it.
Right. Hallelujah. And Mother Barb, special thanks to you. You were so instrumental in my early years. Hallelujah. Bless you, Mother Barb. She's very instrumental behind the scenes.
Man, we getting really sensitive tonight. All this. I got femininity dripping from the walls.
There's tissue behind you, Patty. You want to cry. That's a Kleenex. You know, something came to my mind. I got to interject. You know it's my show, if you want to say mine. It's y'all's show, but I had something come to mind. With this polygyny debate coming up, Daughters of Zion, here's a check for you, okay? Spiritual maturity is what we're all attaining for. And one very important thing is that you don't find things to be funny when it's not funny.
Correct.
And this is foolish behavior, as Pastor said. How would you react or respond to a 50-year-old and a 65-year-old fighting? It's foolish, you know? It's foolish. It might be funny on YouTube, but when you bring it home and you look at what's really happening, I don't want y'all to laugh when it's not the time to laugh. And when he's bringing out these things, who is Pastor Dow? This is a man of Yah that you respect. This is a woman's husband. This is a father figure, a mentor. This is a gifted man, an anointed man. And it is not funny that someone attacks the ministry, that someone attacks a father, that someone attacks a husband. Because if it was your husband, and if it was your father, or someone in your family,
you pull the knives out and the profanity out, and you be ready to fight.
Mm-hmm.
So it is not funny, Daughters of Zion. Just check yourself. When things like this come forth from the pulpit, it's time to fight, it's time to pray, and it's time to war against our enemies.
You got that right.
Right? So I just want to put that out there. As you grow, just so you have that in your belt and in your mind, in the background, when these things come forward and someone is being, a name is being called from the pulpit, it's time to pray. It's
attack
time to pray.
On one of us is an attack against all of us.
Absolutely.
And I'll tell you one thing, still, nevertheless, I'm still going to hand that pastor his ass on that damn debate. I'm going to rip his ass apart. I promise. Well, I forgot, this is Sister Rocket. I'm going to really rip him. I'm going to knock him down. I can't tell you how many pegs. Sister Ashley spoke the truth to y'all. Y'all really, truly need to listen to what she has to say, because she's telling you the truth. It's really not funny. When I mention something about it, it's a spiritual war. And anytime you hear that call right there, you hear just that one little small trumpet, that means it's time for us to start praying against our enemies, because they're sending curses our way. Most people don't understand spiritual warfare, but even when someone speaks evil against you, and all of a sudden you're doing fine through the day, and all of a sudden the spirit of heaven has come over you, that's because somebody somewhere is speaking evil against you. You don't have to know who it is who's doing it. All you need to do is know what to do in that time.
Absolutely. Hallelujah. All right. Keep them rolling in, Daughters of Zion. The show is all about you and getting your answers. We're going to Utah, area code 801. You're live with Pastor Dow. Do you have a question?
Shalom. I don't have a question. I just wanted to call in and to introduce myself and to say thank you. I'm Sister Lala here in Utah. I believe you
Hallelujah.
Spoke with my brother before.
Who is
Yeah, you up under Pastor Tatum. Is that correct?
Pastor Tatum, yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah, that's my faithful brother right there. Matter of fact, Pastor Tatum
me
would
too.
Call he would call me the Honorable Pastor Dow. Matter of fact, I love Pastor Tatum. I taught him everything he needs to know.
Yes, sir, and that's actually why I was calling. I wanted to thank you and thank the sisters and for everything that you guys are doing and for your diligence, for just being so consistent with your teachings and for bringing forth this truth. And I'm the only sister here in Utah, so I'm really encouraged greatly by all the sisters there at Straightway. It's really something to actually see holiness, like being, like, I just can't even put it into words. It's just something else, and it really encourages me. It inspires me. And I just want to thank you guys so much for what you're doing.
Hallelujah. We'll see you in October, maybe, I hope.
Yes, ma'am. I'm really trying. Yes, ma'am.
All right. How far are you from Colorado?
I'm about 45 minutes north of Salt Lake City. So, I mean, I haven't really been to many places, so I don't know how far away it is. But I think it's not too far from Colorado.
We have a beautiful sister by the name of Sister LaShonda in Colorado. And if you don't mind, give me a shout in the dining hall. I'll speak to LaShonda, make sure it's okay with her husband that y'all trade phone numbers just for contact and fellowship out there. If you don't mind, do that in the near future.
Yes, ma'am. I am looking to have more relationships and, like, real relationships with my sisters, because it does get lonely. But it's good to be able to have the YouTube and this chat and the broadcast. I really do appreciate it and just wanted to thank you guys. And I'm most grateful to the Most High Yah for what he's doing and bringing Israel back together. And it's just amazing to see this in this time.
Yes, ma'am. Sister Lala, bless you. Thank you for calling in and introducing yourself.
Hey, make sure y'all stay behind Pastor Tatum out there, all right? Keep supporting the man of Yah.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And thank you so much, Pastor Dell, for all that you're doing. We pray for you every day.
Shalom, shalom.
Hallelujah. Shalom.
Shalom.
All right. Thank you for the caller. Area code 816. We're going to Missouri. Sister Jasmine's phone. Let's see who's on the line. Area code 816. You're live.
Shalom, shalom. This is Sister Silky, Sister Ashley in Kansas City. Shalom, my
shalom.
Sister Ashley.
Hallelujah.
Bless you, Pastor Dow.
Bless you, sister.
I was calling. I had two questions. One, regarding, me being a single sister.
and having a child. And her father, of course, is not in the faith. Her father is not in the faith, not walking in the way.
Yes, ma'am.
And he desires to see her. I believe I emailed you, Sister Ashley, about this, but I wanted to see what Pastor Dow had to say about it. It might be the same, but I just wanted to get confirmation.
Sure.
I'm sorry.
Yes. That's all right. So, go ahead.
He desires to see her, and I was
Sister Silky, just now we're having a bad connection. All right, Sister Silky, I had to let you go. Sister Silky, please call back in. We had a bad connection. We heard you very clearly when you first called, and as you began to explain the situation with the father and your daughter being 5 years old, you started dropping out. So please call back in with your question. I couldn't get my words in because you couldn't hear me, sister. Let's go over to Marilyn. Area code 443. Marilyn, shalom. You're live on Sister to Sister.
Shalom, Sister Ashley and Sister Star. How are you?
Very well, Sister Star. Bless you. Do you have a question or something to add or say?
Bless you. Yes, ma'am. Bless you, Pastor. Shalom. I have something to say, and I also have a question. First, I wanted to say that, well, Sister Ashley, you know, I recently listened to the sister show about a presumptuous woman, and it was beyond a cut. It was like a severed artery. But Mother Bullock said something that stuck with me. So strongly that I feel like it's changed a lot within me in such a short period of time. She said, his spirit is not dwelling in you because you cannot let things go. When I tell you I needed a first aid kit, I needed a first aid kit. And she talked about how we, Pastor, how we hide under other people's anointings and how we need to strive to get the Holy Spirit for ourselves. And it made me really turn the mirror on myself. And you piggyback, Pastor, just in this short session when you mentioned how don't worry about, you know, what other people are doing. You know, if people haven't met, you know, God's conditions, it's not you. And also you mentioned not letting anything steal your joy because it's only stolen if you turn it over. And I just want to say thank you to you, Pastor, and to the ministry and just to everyone for all the help and just everything that you've done for myself and my family.
Well, you're welcome.
Hallelujah. But my question is, Pastor, you the last two videos you did about ammo, I don't own a weapon, but I'm strongly considering just purchasing ammo for the weapon I wish to have. I just don't know if that's like not a bright idea, but with the way things are going, you just don't know.
Yeah, let me tell you something. Even if you don't own a weapon because you live in a communist state, such as New York, New Jersey, all those other places that won't allow you to have weapons, but the government and the criminals have them, hey, it's a good idea to actually buy ammo for the weapon that you desire to have, because knowing that in the future you're not going to be in those places. I think it's very wise for you to actually purchase ammo for the weapon that you think you're going to have or want to have. Now, listen to me very closely. Let's say if you're going to go with a 9mm, you want to get ball 9mm round. And the reason why you want to get ball is because you're going to need plenty for target practice. If you're going to carry inside the city or you're going to use something for self-defense, then you're going to have to use something that they call hollow points or something like that actually spreads out upon impact. But the ball is what you use for ammunition. I will tell you this, as far as military goes, military always use ball rounds in combat no matter what. They don't care if the rounds go through the enemy or whatever damage or carnage it can occur or cause, because it's not a matter of the expense or what we're trying to do as far as stopping the threat. We want to totally eliminate the threat. So I would go with ball and get as much as you can. And then maybe buy like one box out of every 100 rounds of carry.
Okay. All right.
All right. Thank you. Thank you so much, Pastor.
You're welcome.
Bless you. Shalom. I look forward to seeing you all be at the Father's will at Tabernacles. I'm trying to get myself right for true deliverance. I don't want to allow any, you know, demons to come back with company and maybe even aim for the Holy Spirit. So I just ask that you keep me in your prayers, keep my family, my husband's family in your prayers.
Shoot, you can get the Holy Spirit while you're sitting there in Maryland right now. Have you ever attended a mass delivery service?
Yes, one at Passover.
Boy, I tell you, well, you've already seen what this tabernacle looks like after one mass delivery service, haven't you?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Just to let y'all know that y'all bring all these demons in the straightway and stuff, and we got to cast them out.
Hallelujah. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I can go just by my little circle around myself. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Shalom, Sister. Thank you for your call.
Shalom.
Hello. All right, we're jumping to New York. Is it New York? Let's see. Sister Rachel, is it you? Area code 347. You're live on Sister to Sister.
Shalom. Can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am.
Hi. Shalom, Sister Ashley. Bless you, Pastor. Shalom.
Bless you. Shalom.
I just had a question. So it's more of a scenario of what's been going on at home. I live at home with my natural family, and recently, my natural father, he's been making, like, small remarks, you know, for example, calling me a Muslim girl, or just making these jokes that I don't find appropriate. In my head, when he says those things, I hear thoughts, like, sarcastic thoughts, kind of like I want to give a rebuttal, but I sense that that's not a wise option to say those things, being that he is my father. But I wanted to ask Pastor for counsel around whether, how should I approach that? Should I say something as in speak up in truth, ignore him by walking away? What do you advise, Pastor?
No, what you should do is bless him. That's exactly what you should do. You should kindly smile, nod your head, and say, bless you, Father. Thank you very much. Not being sarcastic either. Do
yes,
it in
sir.
Such a way that he actually thinks that you're really truly blessing him. Leave it at that. And remember,
yes, sir.
The Bible teaches us to endure hardness as a good soldier. All right? So just because you're being tested, proven, and tried, know that you're being tested. Know that you're being proven, and know that you're being tried. All right? And don't take offense to it. Is that all right?
Yes, sir. I received that. Thank you. And
keep
I just
smile
want to thank
on your
you
face.
For your time.
They bless you. Thank you very yes. much.
Yes, sir. I received that. And thank you for your time here with us. I'm really honored to hear you on the call with us tonight with the sisters. So bless you. And
well, bless you. You know, Sister Ashley put hooks in my jaw and trouble hooks and everything else, and then turn around and put a 30-06 next to my
That's
head
right,
and stuff,
Pastor.
Along with a couple of Mossberg 500s
right,
and Pastor. Stuff, a 50 cal and everything else. But no, I actually came up to her ass. But hey, it's well needed.
Hallelujah.
Y'all good.
It is. He's good.
Yes,
bless
is.
You, Sister
Hallelujah.
Rachel.
Bless
Hallelujah.
You. Shalom.
Shalom.
See, the devil don't know what we're doing, Ashley.
What we doing, Pastor?
Well, the devil don't know that the only thing we're doing is solidifying the base. You know what I mean? Because the women, the mothers, they're the foundation of our whole entire society. You understand?
I think.
Yeah, they're the first line teachers.
Yes.
Teachers at home, they want to take care of the men. Is that right?
Mm-hmm.
Very instrumental. The highest calling in the universe is mother.
Yeah.
It really truly is. It's the highest calling in the universe. And when people already have such, man, you've been on the internet, see what they say about me? Oh, Jesus. Well, don't worry about it. Save yourself the grief.
Right, not really.
You know what I mean? But anyway, hey, think about it. What did they do with Jesus? Did they kill him?
Weinberger.
What about Paul? Did they kill him? Yeah, they killed him, killed Peter. What about the prophets? In other words, anybody that stands for righteousness, this world has got what? A death warrant for them. So don't worry about it. You're all fine.
Yes, sir.
You get it?
Yes, sir.
I'm on a broadcast, but I'm here preaching to Sister Jordan.
Right.
All right.
Right. Hallelujah. That's our pastor. Let's go to Pennsylvania. Area code 484, you're live. What say you, or do you have a question for Pastor Dow?
Shalom, this is Sister Katie.
Hey, Sister Katie. How you doing, Sister Katie?
I'm all right. I am working on myself, and things are a little rough, but I have a lot of faith, and I'm very strong, and I'm going to keep going until the Most High comes back.
Good.
How are you doing?
I'm all right. I'm all right. Just make sure that hard-headed man is working on himself, too.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Kate, I got a question I want to ask you.
Yes.
Hey, what do you think about the first time that you actually met me up there?
It was very great. I couldn't stop smiling. it was awesome. I was actually like a little nervous of meeting you, but after I met you, it was just fine. It was very good.
Hallelujah. Come on, what's your question?
Well, I didn't really have a question. I just wanted to say shalom and that this show is very edifying. I did write down a lot of notes. Like how everybody was calling in and saying things, and it was like a lot of stuff. I just had to write notes, but I just wanted to call in and say shalom, and I love all y'all. I love all the sisters, and I'll do anything for y'all.
Yeah, I think she's coming, yeah.
Hallelujah. We love you as well. We'll see you in October, hopefully. Y'all wills, and you be here.
Hallelujah. Thank you. Shalom.
Yes, ma'am. Shalom. All right, jumping to Missouri. Only one call left, unless any of you have something to add, say, or ask. 16, you're live. Is it Sister Suki again? Let's see if we got a better signal, sister.
Yes, ma'am. Can you all hear me?
Shalom. I can hear you. There's a little bit of feedback in the background. Where are you? Car?
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm driving.
Okay. Yes, ma'am. As long as we're not on speaker, we're all right so far. Go ahead and ask again. We got your scenario. The father is not in the faith. You have a daughter that's 5. Go ahead.
Yes, and I was just seeing what Pastor Dale had to give counsel about that situation. Should I just not, cut him off completely or not allow him access? Because it's really tough anyway because I'm living an hour outside of the city. So me getting to him or, taking her to see him is strenuous on me, honestly. So I was just seeing what Pastor Dale, the counsel he would have on that situation.
What's his interactions with you? How much is his effort before Pastor answers? What's his effort in being a part of your daughter's life?
It's like nil to none. It's very slim. He doesn't have reliable communication. He doesn't have a reliable home to stay in. Very small effort.
All right. First of all, number one, I would default to Pastor Corey. Whatever Pastor Corey tells you to do, that's what you need to do. Because Pastor Corey is an anointed man of Yah, full of wisdom. He knows exactly what he's doing. Since you've called into this broadcast, I'm assuming that y'all have already had this discussion. I don't think that, number one, you're even married or have any obligation whatsoever at all. I mean, did y'all have a marriage license, or is this one of these what the world will call... Y'all had fornication and a child come from it, even though I don't believe that. Is that what happened?
Yes, sir. The second. Yes, sir.
All right. Is he paying any child support?
No, sir.
Good. You have no obligation to him whatsoever at all. You turn the page and distance yourself as far as you can from him because you are not under any obligation whatsoever at all unless that the courts, secular courts themselves, have made you obligated. Is that true?
No, that is not true.
I will turn the page. I will turn the page because no child is a mistake. We may make mistakes and we may sin in ourselves and stuff, but no child's a mistake. And I would actually get up under whatever Pastor Corey leadership is and whatever he says, that is exactly what I would do.
Hallelujah. Yes, sir. I don't know if he knew the extent of our communication or his effort, on, like, I don't know if Pastor Corey knew the extent of his effort, so he was just saying as long as it doesn't contradict any of the laws and the rules that we go by, then, you know, he'll be okay with seeing her and stuff. But, yeah, I completely agree, and I receive that, sir. Hallelujah.
You communicate with Pastor Corey. If that's something that he needs a little bit more clarity on, I promise you he'll call me, and then we'll get together from there and we'll go forward.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Shalom. Hallelujah. Shalom. Hallelujah. Bless you, Pastor.
You see, that's one thing I can't stand, is these boot-licking niggas that can't take care of their responsibilities. I don't care if you be a black man, white man, red, yellow, blue, purple, green, or brown. That's the one thing that I literally just cannot tolerate, is for men who so-called sit down and bed women, and then you stupid women sit up there and open up your legs and allow these Negroes to the niggas and honkies, hoogies, spits, wops, crackers, and whatever else, wetbacks, whatever you want to call them, because y'all seeking for something to try to make up the head for your insecurities and everything else that you got problems with and stuff. But anytime a man that negates and totally disregards his responsibility, to me, is less than a piece of shit that actually fall down from our cows that fall in the back 40, and I don't have too much toleration with them whatsoever at all. So if that's nothing legally binding, you turn the page and move on, walk in the news of life, distance yourself from that, I'm going to save my words for that one right there. Beep, 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 beep. And then get yourself free from them so they won't be following you as you continue to go on in the faith.
So is it true a child can live without a mother but not without a father? In development, we have some single mother situations. We don't have many single fathers. What say you for guidance, Pastor? What would you do?
I think in the early parts of the year, because the Torah is very, very clear, is that a child needs the mother. It needs the nurturing at a certain age. Then the father takes over. Otherwise, it's going to be a false balance. It's going to be a very bad situation. For instance, right now, we look at little Nehemiah right there. That's all motherhood, every bit of it. When he gets about 3-4 years old, that's father from all that point on. You understand?
Absolutely.
Y'all get that? That's Torah. That's the natural order of things.
Yes. Hallelujah. Good answer. All right, let's go over to South Carolina. Area code 803, you're live with Pastor Dow. Do you have a question?
I don't have a question. My name is Sister Douglas, and I wanted to introduce myself to the Straightway family. So
well,
I've been
shalom.
Trying to get in touch with you for the past 3 weeks, and I'm finally through.
Hallelujah.
Write that number down.
All right.
Hey, where are you at in South Carolina?
I'm in Aiken, South Carolina. It's near Augusta, Georgia. It's
Ooh,
right on that
deep.
Border.
Yeah, you're real deep. You're probably about 4 or 5 hours from what, Spartanburg or Simpson?
Well, I'm about 2 or 3. Let me see. I'm about 3. I'm really from the coast, and I'm new to this area. We came up here, and we purchased some property and we purchased a homestead just recently, and we purchased it up in the country, up in this area. So that's what we're doing
now. We need to put you in touch with Elder Austin and the Saints there and up in Simpsonville, South Carolina. But anyway, go ahead, sister. We got your number and everything. What you got?
Well, I just wanted to call and say, you know, I wanted to talk to you. I've been following you now for a while, since about November of last year.
November last year. Did I give you the cooties or something?
No. Pastor Dow, I wanted to say that, you know, because I got kind of, I've been a little bit busy this past couple of weeks, but I wanted to say it seems like women have been coming against you because of the way that you talk. But there's
True.
A lot of people just like me that is a welcomed tone that you use, because we need to have that kind of talk. Women are so, they've been told, you know, we have this thing where people say, you know, happy wife, happy life. Women are running everything. They're doing everything. They can't be told anything. They get their feelings hurt all the time. And it was what you said. You started talking about women, how they ran their mouth, that gave me conviction. I listen because I've been around this for a long time. And I just wanted to just say, don't back off what you're doing, because there's many women like us that really, we look for that. We look for that strength.
Sister, your voice is like a rose petal garden in a springtime shower. It's just so beautiful. Keep on speaking. Stay home.
Well, another thing, just to encourage the women that are, you know, that are concerned, my first thought of the straightway women when I first saw them was that they were free. They weren't bound by, you know, the makeup and the who I got to look better than and all the competition that goes on out there. They were free, and that's what I saw. And I think when someone comes against the community and say, well, they look like they're oppressed, it's because they want to change things. And like you say, you know what, they can get going. Kick them to the street, because that kind of stuff poisons a whole lot. And you need a strong person to run a community. You can't have a weakling. And I just wanted to say, keep going.
Well, no doubt about it. You sound like a woman of intelligence, because, I mean, did you ever see that Shabbat service? We was actually, matter of fact, we still got the newsletter on makeup and actually posted a bunch of pictures of our sisters when they were in the world wearing makeup as opposed to where they are now. Did you ever see that service?
I didn't get a chance to see that, but I've been going through the archives. This has been my church.
I'll see if I can find them and try my best to post them up this Shabbat. But what's amazing to me is that everybody thinks that we ain't never been in the world. You know, I mean, all of us. You understand what I mean?
Exactly.
It's utterly amazing. And now we have intelligent sisters. We have very highly intelligent sisters in the ministry. But, hey, the Bible said if any man be ignorant, let him be ignorant.
It's nothing you can do about people who want to be dumb on purpose.
Yeah, you've been listening.
You've been listening. Sister David, bless you.
Oh,
sister, hallelujah.
Yes. Well,
anything
thank
else?
You. Shalom, shalom. I'm going to call in again. This is my prep night. My husband's out hunting, and we've been working on the property. And Pastor, I was saying that we've been into buying the silver, and we've been prepping. I got a gun. We've been buying ammo. I mean, we've been kind of following it. And I just wanted to say that, you know, I know that, you know, I'm not going to give you any lip service here and take up too much time, but it's just so refreshing for me, having been born again 28 years ago, and I abandoned Sunday worship, so I was alone for a long time, and just felt like I was so estranged from everybody. I didn't have anybody that was like me, and there were no communities around here, and I wasn't a big internet person. When I came across the Straightway Truth, I was like, this is my family. If I never even get a chance to meet you guys, I knew that you people were my family, and that the Most High would somehow get me in touch with people like myself. So I'm just so blessed. And I'm blessed. I love you, Sister Ashley. I've been listening to you now for the past couple of weeks, and I want to say keep going, Sister. And Sister Mother Carol, she's so encouraging to me. She the things that she said last week, you know, just
yes.
Still keeps me convicted and keeps me going, keeps me moving in the direction that I should be going. So I really love you guys.
Hallelujah. We love you as well. Welcome to the faith. Welcome to the fight. Just to keep pressing. You know you have a whole body of people that are there for you when you need us. Pick up the phone. Call us. Email us. StraightwayHelpMeets@gmail.com. Stay close as you can.
Okay. And I want to be able to get in touch with some of the brothers and sisters here in South Carolina. And you said something about Simpsonville, which is not too far from where I am.
Right. I mean, the number that you're calling in on right now, that's the number that we can use for your contact. Is that correct?
Okay. Yes, that is. That's a number, yes. That's not my cell number.
All right. Well, I promise you, you will hear from some sisters from South Carolina here within the next day or so.
Wonderful. Wonderful. Well, I bless you all. And I thank you for taking the time to listen to me. I'm rambling because I was running and I was trying to scramble to get on the phone before you got off. So you have a wonderful, wonderful evening, and I look forward to talking to you soon again.
Hallelujah. Thank you for listening. Shalom.
Shalom.
That's beautiful.
Hallelujah. Pastor says it's beautiful.
Yeah, y'all got a lot of people listening, y'all.
I agree. We have a lot of people. And you know, the colors go up every time Pastor puts a YouTube video out with me right beside him talking about the Straightway Sisters. I'm like, here goes our numbers. Area code 816. You're going to Missouri, Pastor. Let's see who we're speaking to. You're live on Sister to Sister.
Shalom, shalom. This is Sister Jasmine Roberts, not Teamer.
Hallelujah.
No, I didn't have a question or anything. I just came in actually to speak to the pastor because I haven't introduced myself really formally to the ministry of a straight way, formally anyway. And I just wanted to say that, you know, being a fatherless child, not that my father has passed away or anything, he just hasn't been in my life, and but listening to Pastor Dow has really filled somewhat of a void, you know, not having a father. And, you know, I just wanted to bless you and bless you for, you know, ordaining pastors like Pastor Corey. He is my pastor. I love him. I love Straightway Casey. And I just want to bless you for that. And that's all I have to say. And I bless y'all. And I see y'all at Tabernacle.
My advice is you listen to what that pastor has to say, because that's a righteous pastor. His heart and his wife's heart is in the right manner and the right way. They will not lead you wrong.
Yes, sir. Thank you. Bless you.
Hallelujah. Bless you, Sister Jasmine. Thanks for calling to introduce yourself.
Bless you. Shalom.
Shalom. All right, I'm going to ministry break just in case that last caller wants to call in right after that break. But if not, we're going to end the show. Let's lean over to Sister Wenda's voice. We'll be right back.
Shalom, this is Sister Wenda. I hope that all of you are enjoying the broadcast that you're listening to right now. We appreciate each and every last one of you, our faithful listeners and supporters of the Straight Way Truth radio broadcast. We try to make sure that we do our due diligence and do our best to ensure that you have the best broadcast, as well as the truth, coming to you in the hour that we're living in right now. If you would like to help us in this endeavor, your offering will be greatly appreciated in the work of the Ministry of the Most High YAH. Our mailing address for your gift, offering, or letter of support is Charles Dowell, Jr. That's Charles Dowell, Jr., and Dowell is spelled D-O-W-E-L-L. 506 Ellington Drive. Ellington is spelled E-L-L-I-N-G-T-O-N. P.O. Box 32, Lafayette, Tennessee. And Lafayette is spelled L-A-F-A-Y-E-T-T-E 37083. Again, our mailing address is Charles Dowell, Jr., 506 Ellington Drive, P.O. Box 32, Lafayette, Tennessee, 37083. If you would like to contact us by way of phone, the country code is 1, area code 615-688-3025. That's 1-615-688-3025. You may leave a message there, and be the Father's will, we will do whatever we can to try to return your message. It is our hope and our prayer that as you continue to listen to the Straightway Truth Ministry, and as you apply the teachings of this ministry, that you are finding peace and growth within you, your family, and life as well. Please tell others so that the truth may also have an impact and touch others' lives, so that they may enjoy the benefits of the truth of Jesus Christ, just like we all are. Shalom, the King is coming.
Hallelujah. Special shout out to Brother Steve and Sister Wenda for all that you do behind the scenes. What a great show. And a hand clap for our pastor. Hallelujah, that we follow as he follows Yeshua. We will now end and conclude the show. What a great edifying show. And thank you for all the comments in the chat room. I know many of you heard things that blessed your soul. That's what it's about. And we thank Pastor for his time. I guess I'm going to blow the shofar. And I miss you, Sister Jennifer. We'll be back next week with a great show. We're talking about racism. Hallelujah. So hold tight. Come back next week. Thank you all for listening in. Shalom, shalom. Thank you.
I will give you pastors according to mine heart, which shall feed you with knowledge and understanding.
And Yahweh, Elohim, said,
It is not good for the man to be alone. I am going to make a helper for him as his counterpart.
Holy Yahweh Almighty,
we're singing,
Holy Yahweh.